Okay, so if grab some coffee, grab some groceries, and why don't we get hopping? First, I want to salute everyone who is here because you did not let Kirk, Glenn Burns, and the weather people scare you away. So we know who the hardy people are who really care about Georgia government. So congratulations for being here. I'm Walter Jones. I'm a political reporter with the Morris News Service, and I'm on the board here at the Press Club. So I appreciate you coming for our club's annual General Assembly Unplugged. There is one plug, so I got the Press Club commercial. The Press Club is one of the largest and most active press clubs in the world. If you're not already a member, we'd like you to join. There's information on the website at atlantapressclub.org. We have a lot of great programs like this one today. Our Newsmaker Luncheon on February the 11th with Mayor Kasim Reed is actually going to be a cage match between Maria Saporta and Mayor Reed. But he doesn't know that. We're also accepting nominations for our 2015 Awards of Excellence, and you can find information about that also on the website. Now, I hope you'll silence your phone, but don't turn it off, because on here you have today's hashtag, APC Unplugged, and you have the Twitter handles for our guests. So let me introduce them. First, to my left is Greg Lustein, a political reporter who covers the governor's office and state politics for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. He's one of the insiders. He joined the newspaper in 2012 after spending 7 years in the Atlanta Bureau of the Associated Press. And I'm curious, do you type with two fingers?
Nope, all home rookies.
Okay, that's why you're not with AP anymore. I just noticed, though, that that so many AP reporters are two-finger typed. I don't know the connection there. But anyway, we're glad to have you. Next to him is Maggie Lee. She's state and Metro Atlanta politics and government reporter. Her articles appear in the Macon Telegraph, Creative Loafing, and many more. Beside her is Sanj Parrish, who is a reporter for WSB Radio, where she's been since 1995. She covers politics, legislative, transportation, and education news, and today she's going to be doing a lot of weather reporting.
There we go.
And far end of the table is Dave Williams, a government reporter for the Atlanta Business Chronicle, where he's been since 2008. He covers Georgia government he's been doing that since 1999 from Georgia, but even beyond that, he was in D.C. where he covered our legislative delegation. So he knows the ropes as well. We have an interesting session to talk about. So one of the things that I wanted to throw out the panel to begin with is the governor's State of the State address. Normally, that's when governors lay out a long and ambitious legislative agenda. And for months, we've been talking about how this year was going to be the session to address education. And then the governor said, nah, we're going to do that next year. So, with that switch, what does that do to the session? And Greg, I know you've written a little bit about that, so kick that off.
Sure. Well, it's kind of left the vacuum. I mean, we've heard from Governor Deal since 2013 that he wanted to change the education funding formula. This is an issue. Really, the main issue he even campaigned on. He went all around the state talking about how the state funding formula needs to be changed. It's a 30-year-old formula that needs to be updated. And then the run up to this session, you talked about it over and over again. You convened an education reform panel just to do that very thing. And then in his state of state speech, he spent about the first half talking about what he had accomplished in the past. And then the second part of the second half, talking about why it's difficult to do it this year. Part of the reason was the education reform panel didn't come out with its recommendations until November or December, so a lot of people didn't make much of a headway. But part of the reason, too, is there's resistance from very powerful people in the legislature, including House Speaker David Ralston, mm-hmm. over the merit pay part of it, and that the groundwork really hadn't been laid yet. So in the absence of a very ambitious, remember in the past years, last year you had Opportunity School District, which was a huge debate, as well as transportation funding, the new tax that Governor Deal put a lot of his eggs behind. Before that, you had criminal justice and Hope Scholarship. So you've had these very ambitious legislative items in the past from Governor Deal. And this year, there's very little sweeping, dramatic proposals from the governor on the table. I can't think of a single big item that he's really pushing. So it's leaving a sort of a vacuum where the casino proposal, the religious liberty debate, you're seeing the different caucuses in the House and Senate come up with their own important policy items, but not nearly as that doesn't have the amount of juice that the governors would have had behind them. So it's going to be a very interesting, quick, and political session, given that the election's right around the corner.
Anybody else want to weigh in on what's going to fill that vacuum?
I don't know. I've got a comment, though, on the state of the state. So I think, in reality, it was actually a way to get Republican lawmakers reelected. I think that maybe Governor Deal felt pressure from some of the leaderships in the Republican Party. You saw what happened to Governor Barnes. You know, he felt the ire of teachers, and he was not reelected. So truly, when I was listening to that speech, that was what I was thinking, that he's bowing to pressure. He did throw in the merit pay. I mean, he's holding off the merit pay, but he did throw in the 3% raise for teachers. So I think he's trying to win them back and avoid what happened to Governor Barnes. It's not for him, but for the other Republicans who are going to be up for reelection.
I think he's also bowing to political reality, because when we started previewing the session as far back as the fall, everything anybody said was, we're going to have a quick session, we have to get out on the campaign trail. So it's just it's a repeat of 2 years ago, because the qualifying deadline has been moved up now so far into March. Lawmakers want to get out and go out and campaign for re-election. So obviously education reform is complicated. Most issues the legislature tackles are complicated. So other than passing a budget, a balanced budget, which they have to, I'm not looking for a whole lot of accomplishments out of this session.
Well, okay. One area that I would sort of follow up on that is, does that mean that, to Dave's point, that if the legislature is going to do any heavy lifting, taking on really tough, new, complicated issues that they haven't looked at before, is it going to take more than 2 years to do it? Are they going to be able to do that in the off year, or will it take 3 or 4 years, or you know, what does that do to the pace of actual legislative business?
Well, as far as the QBE funding formula goes, I mean, he's been talking about that since he was first elected, and we've seen, you know, it's taken finally until December, I think, is when that report came out, and we thought it was going to happen this session, and he's going to hold off yet again, and who knows? I mean, that's such a complicated matter. Who knows? You know, that will even happen next year, so that's a good point as far as that part of education reform is concerned.
Well, Maggie, you're not going to get off the line. For you, let me ask, does the absence of the governor's agenda change the priority for issues like medical marijuana or even recreational marijuana, which is now coming up?
So we have a total of 7 cannabis-related bills out there and more to come. You talk about moving a medical marijuana bill, the bill about Alan Peake's bill about cultivating medical cannabis in Georgia. Until he brings the governor on board, he's, you know, he's got enough signatures for it to pass the House. I don't know what the prospects are in the Senate at this point. Hearings start next week. I guess that will show how much opposition he has, which has so far come mostly from the law enforcement community. He's got it through one House, but that's only one step, I think.
What does that mean, that the recreational marijuana bills are going to hit even tougher slide?
Well, they've been sitting without hearings since last year, so but you mentioned like long-term issues. There is a legislator from Augusta who's just filed a bill to make possession of marijuana a misdemeanor, and he frames it as a criminal justice reform, not a marijuana bill, because this possession, people get locked up for it, and they lose some of their benefits, they lose some of their rights. He said himself, this is a big thing, it may take a while.
This is one of the most, Alan Peake is one of the most fascinating lawmakers to watch the session, because he left Governor Deal's floor leadership team and broke openly with the governor over this very issue that Maggie was talking about. And the governor has made it very clear he's very skeptical of any cultivation, in-state cultivation. And then we had Alan Peake this week basically admit to being, violating law by ferrying these drugs across state lines. And we've had a number of other people come out and say this. The governor remains very skeptical from what I've heard. I haven't been able to ask him about it this week since then. But everything he said was he's skeptical of this legislation. He has all these concerns with law enforcement officials. But meanwhile, Alan Peake has a very powerful ally in this fight in House Speaker David Ralston, who has backed him unequivocally and said this will come up for a vote in the House. He's already got, 100 plus sponsors, which is more than enough he needs for this legislation. So it's going to be, I think this is one of the most interesting battles to watch this evening.
Well, Greg, also this void seems to create more air for RFRA, and now we have this new First Amendment Defense Act. Where do you see that going?
Yeah, remember, this is a session where last year Republican lawmakers passed a $900 million package of tax fees and tax hikes and new fees. They passed the medical marijuana bill. They passed an insurance mandate for autism coverage. They did a lot of things that you wouldn't think a traditional Republican session would do. So there's a lot of clamoring from the base, and we saw this at the GOP convention in Athens for very conservative efforts that lawmakers can run on when they go home for the May primaries. A lot of them are worried. I was talking to dozens of them at the Wild Hog Supper, and I asked them all the same questions. Do you have a challenger? And more often than not, they're worried about someone. In an era where Donald Trump is leading the polls in Georgia and, most of the South, they're worried that nobody could come out of nowhere and challenge them and give them a real fight. So there's a clamor for RFRA. There's a clamor for some sort of religious liberty. FATA, this new thing that we still haven't even seen the text of yet, is the First Amendment Defense Act. That might not be a go this year because, RFRA has taken this is the third year this has been a debate. But religious liberty, even the governor said yesterday, he understands the need for it. The business community is very against it. But there might be some sort of way to thread the needle and find something that can be acceptable to the business community and maybe somewhat acceptable to the Republican base. And I know that that is what's being talked about right now as we speak.
What Dave, you covered business, what's
Well, I think that it's interesting to me that when you talk to the folks who sponsor RFRA, they seem to be more willing to find compromise language that they feel the business community would accept than the business community does. This group has just formed over 100 members. Every major corporation in the state that's fighting this legislation is just unbelievably influential. I think some kind of fallback position that might give Republicans some political cover would be the Pastor Protection Bill. I don't see the business community having a big problem with that. It's nowhere near as broad as these other bills. And whether that's enough to satisfy the base, we have to see. But that's the kind of bill I can see passing much more so than a referral of a new bill.
I would agree with that. I think the Pastor Protection Act is something that we're going to see. And even this latest one by Senator Kirk in the first, what's it called? The First
Amendment Defense
Act. First Amendment Defense Act. Because it deals with the nonprofit organizations and protection for faith-based organizations. He mentioned yesterday the adoption agencies who feel strongly about, you know, adopting out to same-sex couples, and he mentioned youth groups and things. So I think, you know, probably of all the bills that have been filed, it could be the one, the Pastor Protection Act, as well as the latest one.
I would add too that any of these bills don't necessarily have to become law to be useful to the signatories. You know, you might sign it and say, well, I signed this excellent bill, it didn't become law, but that's, you know, that's still a pretty good thing to be able to say on the stump, is that you supported, you know, such and such bill that, you know, your base will appreciate.
Well, you know, those of us who are Georgia natives remember Tom Merton. And one of the roles, one of the reasons a lot of people liked Tom Murphy, a lot of legislators privately said they liked him, is that he was a foil, you know, he was the bad guy, that you could propose a bill like that you knew he would stop, where you could say, well, by golly, I did it, or the legislators could say, oh, well, I would have voted for it, you know, if Tom Murphy had only put it on the floor. So the question I thought about in the shower that I wanted to ask. Well, at least in that.
Think about the shower.
But well, I shouldn't have missed that. Okay, driving in, I thought of this. So, which chamber is better run?
What?
Well, I'm thinking from a leadership standpoint. You know, is the House or the Senate better run this year?
What do you mean by better?
Well, more effectively, you know, from the standpoint of the legislators, or to accomplish what their aims are.
I would think that the Senate is probably more controlled, and as far as, you know, what, and they try to come together more as a consensus, the leadership does. I think over in the House, yes, you have the Speaker, and pretty much, you know, people are going to try to side with him, but you still have, I think, more of a divide among the Republicans in the House, maybe just because there's more of them in the House. But I think you see more of a break off, you know, from, you know, your standard, yeah, we're going to go along party lines, than you do in the Senate. I think the Senate is much more strict party lines.
Well, the House is harder to run, too. I mean, it's just, there's more members, there's, what, 90s? 120-ish Republican members, and Speaker Ralston knows better than most what happens when you tick off the leadership, because he tried to House Speaker Glenn Richardson unsuccessfully before it was successful. So there's coup plots, there's all this crazy stuff that goes on but behind the scenes, so it's a hard chamber to run.
Well, then looking at the Democrats in the House and the Senate, do you have a sense of which one there is doing a better job?
They have starkly different strategies. I mean, the Democratic caucus in the House plays more of the, I guess it would be the loyal opposition in part, that they try to affect and influence legislation. And they knew, especially this last year, that they could play a very important piece in getting the constitutional majorities, the 120 plus votes needed for the Opportunity School District. So they played their chips pretty effectively to get transit funding and other priorities they wanted. In the Senate side, they're a lot more, unabashedly aggressive about Democratic policies. They're calling for, you know, they're the ones calling more for Medicaid expansion and some proposals that might not ever get off the ground, rather than looking to do more compromise. And I think for a party, you need both. You need both sides. You need the types working to play on the base, and also the types looking to affect legislation, because they know that what could appeal to the base might not ever happen in a Republican legislature.
Exactly. I think that goes back to several years ago when we had the HOPE reform legislation, when HOPE was kind of starting to look really financially difficult, and it was the House Democrats who worked with the governor and got a bill as much toward what they thought they could get as was realistically possible. And the Senate Democrats kind of dug in and were holding out to kind of make the means tested, for example, and they kind of got nowhere with that. I wanted to change the focus, if you don't mind, to I want to talk about casinos and horse racing. I think that's probably one of the more interesting issues for this session. I'm not optimistic necessarily that either one will pass, But I think it's interesting that there's two, of course, they kind of go arm in arm in one way, but in another way, there's two different strategies going on, and they have to be looked at separately. The casino legislation, the idea strategically by supporters there is to push a constitutional amendment. They understand the session's not going to be going very long. They want to do the constitutional amendment, which by nature is not very complicated, and hold off the enabling legislation seemingly until after it's voted on. I've kind of talked to one of the sponsors about that's immediately going to give cover to all the opponents. So why would somebody want to vote for something that they don't know the details of? But that's the strategy they want to pursue anyway. Horse racing, on the other hand, unlike casinos, they've now come forward with a specific project, so you would certainly think that something dangling there, we want to do this if you let us, will help the cause there. And they also, unlike the casino supporters, are going to push enabling legislation, which they just introduced, and it looks like that might be considered along a more, what you would call normal procedure, where the enabling bill gets some kind of discussion, because people do want to know if they're going to vote on the constitutional amendment, then how's this going to work if we pass it? So that really, to me, makes more sense. Then you also have to remember how long it took to get the Sunday sales, and think about how long that took. So to try to get something like this done in one session is going to be, I think, overly optimistic.
Well, and actually, that was where I was headed, because you're talking about the Democrats, and would they be able to trade? Would they have anything to trade? Their vote's going to be needed to pass either constitutional amendment to expand legalized gambling, and anything they could trade for will be in the enabling legislation. So, like I said, they probably want MARTA. That's something they've been pushing for a long time. They want needs-based scholarships. Would they be willing to vote on just the constitutional amendment this year and the enabling legislation later in hopes that whatever they're bargaining for will be delivered?
Well, any bargaining they do would have to be done with the constitutional amendment, because that's the one that requires a two-thirds vote. So,
but the goodie would be delivered.
That's true.
Somewhere
else. That's a good point. The other interesting wrinkle of this is, and you can argue this if you're a supporter of the constitutional amendment, that nothing's going to happen until these things get voted on locally and wherever you want to put a casino or a racetrack. So that of course delays it even more, but it also makes kind of an interesting dynamic that you could say you're voting for the constitutional amendment to give local control, give people choice. Sometimes that's a cover.
I think a bargaining chip as far as the Democrats go, as far as the casinos, is they want that needs-based scholarship. And the sponsor has told me that's something, the higher the tax base that they will require from casinos could make that possible. And I think that was the discrepancy in the enabling legislation, is no one could agree on what that tax base. I think it came in initially at 12%, and the sponsor has told me that they're, you know, thinking that upwards maybe even 20 to 23%. The governor has even said, you know, he might consider it, even though it doesn't get at his desk, but he might support it if it was a higher tax base. So I do think that's one thing that the Democrats could come on board, is if they knew that with that greater amount of a tax base and a needs-based scholarship could be included in that, because the profits are going to the Hope Scholarship anyway, or, you know, as far as the tax revenue, that's how it's written in, is that it would go to help shore up the Hope Scholarship. So with a greater tax base, you could get a needs-based scholarship in there, more money for pre-K, so I think definitely that's a bargaining chip.
But, Maggie, do you see rank-and-file legislators having any kind of decision or preference on this, or are they just waiting to see what plays out?
I would think a lot of Republican legislators I've talked to, and a lot of Republican candidates, we actually had two big special elections in Middle Georgia this year, but I heard from a lot of Republicans that they are really skeptical about casinos, and it was the exact same argument you heard when we first passed the HOPE grant, that, you know, you're going to have low-income people going to the casino possibly, and, you know, there's probably better ways for people to spend their money than going in a casino. I heard a lot of Republicans just not ready to step up on a casino at all.
And that kind of speaks to the heart of it. I mean, the reason why the transportation tax passed last year was because the second day of the session, you had Lieutenant Governor Cagle, Governor Deal, and House Speaker Ralston all go up to Eggs and Issues breakfast and say unequivocally they supported this nearly $1 billion new package of tax, new closing tax breaks and new tax breaks and new fees. You haven't had any very powerful, you know, you're Brandon Beach, but you haven't had any, I guess, powerful leader with a lot of juice behind them yet saying that they support legalizing gambling. And you've had Governor Deal kind of go the opposite way, saying he still opposes it, that yes, he might, you know, let the enabling legislation, which is the actual legislation that says how this would work, go into effect without signing it into law if the constitutional amendment passes first. But that's a pretty big caveat there. And so without that sort of big, you know, powerful lawmaker, and there might be yet one coming, but without that yet, it's really hard to see this getting too much juices here.
Well, let me ask one last question, and then we'll kind of throw it open to we have a very informed audience, so their questions will be better than mine. One last thing I wanted to ask, just throw out, is the budget. Have we seen any surprises, any interesting nuggets in the budget? Usually the budget hearings are where you hear some little quirky stuff. I mean, I wrote a story this week about the GBI saying that they need 20 more agents just to investigate shootings of cops, or with cops, which I thought was a little odd. Last year they got 8 agents for the new area of elder abuse, and they need 20 for investigating cop shootings. So, but anyway, have y'all seen any kind of interesting things in the budget or something that's missing?
One fascinating thing was $20 million more for the criminal justice reforms that aim to hit lower recidivism rates. The governor wants to spend $14 million of that just to reopen a metro state prison and turn it into some sort of rehabilitation hub, I guess, reentry hub for prisoners who are being released from prison, so they can help transition them back into society. So there's always interesting little tidbits that you can pick up. You can write a million stories just on the budget that way.
I would say one thing that's not in the budget that I'm hearing increasing chatter about is rural health. A lot of rural hospitals are closing. A lot of them serve a disproportionate share of people who, for whatever reason, aren't able to pay, don't have insurance, don't have enough money. The speakers talked about it. Republican and Democrat legislators have both said it's a priority. The question now is, where does the money come from? We do have an independent legislator who wants to license casinos in order to use the revenue for rural health. I think he's maybe the only one who's talking about that so far. But yeah, Republicans and Democrats both are starting to put rural health a little higher on the agenda.
Going back to what your point about the GBI and more agents for that, is because all these local jurisdictions are wanting the GBI to investigate police-involved shootings. So I think they were feeling overwhelmed when everybody is coming out, you know, asking for them to, and they'll tell you, just immediately turn over to the GBI so they can investigate. So I bet that's the point on that. Going on what Greg said as far as criminal justice reform, yeah, he mentioned the education of the prisoners, more education programs. He also mentioned shoring up prisons too. There's a bunch of money in there for that. And he's saying that with a lot of the nonviolent criminals, you know, no longer in the system or, you know, hoping not to return to the system, you're left with your hardened criminals, your sex offenders, your violent offenders. So there's a big push to shore up security measures. I mean, we're all the time hearing about the problems within the prisons.
Yeah, like yesterday at a big press mm-hmm. conference about the smuggling cell phones. And so a fallback career for journalists apparently is being a prison guard, plenty of money being paid off. It might be a short career, but.
Well, I, once again this year, did not see any money in there, and somebody might have found it, but I didn't. Money for the state-run venture capital fund in West Georgia, which continues to be very, very, very slow, glacially, in fact, getting off the ground. It's been around for several years, but still hasn't really had any significant money. They got $10 million through the region's budget, of all things, and that helped them out. They finally have, just for the last couple of weeks or so, found their first investment they want to make. They found a company that they want to invest in, so they're all starting to make some moves. And last session, they were going to get $55 million right at the end of the session, but then their legislation got caught in the middle of the Capco issue and wound up being vetoed by the governor over Capco. So therefore, they still haven't got much money. And again, the governor always seems to stay away from this in his budget, and every year since they've been started, it winds up being a political football between the House and Senate. So Lieutenant Governor Cagle's one of his prize programs, so they always support it. And now the Speaker Austin likes to say, you know, what's there and why is there a need for the public sector to do this venture capital investing? There's a lot of the private sector doing that, so it's sort of a duplication. He's not very supportive of it. So it looks like that'll be a debate again during the as the budget unfolds in the House and Senate.
Okay. Well, let's hear from y'all. Suzanne?
One of the eggs and issues that Lieutenant Governor talked about, rural health, and he mentioned something that he's working with public health and I'm trying to figure out what he was talking about. Can you all figure it out? Some reform with public health and gen.
I would say one of the issues is that, you know, there's federal money and there's state money. A lot of counties out there lack a general practitioner. Okay, a lot of counties don't even have a doctor, much less like an OBGYN or a psychiatrist or whatnot. A lot of these rural counties are served by what's called a federally qualified health center, which is essentially, you know, a federally funded clinic that can get some state money too. I think that's the issue. It's confusing. Nobody knows where this money's going to come from. Is it going to come from the federal government? Is it going to come from, well, like, or it even gets local. Some cities and counties will pay a doctor, you know, give them some sort of emolument to come open their office out in a little rural town. So I would say the search is on for money. Is there anybody from the Lieutenant Governor's office here talking about? No.
I mean, I'm still trying to ask him what it's about.
I mean, in general, Republicans are trying to thread the needle. There's an increasing number of Republicans who are saying publicly, just yesterday, Fran Miller said it for the first time that I heard, he's saying Medicaid expansion is going to happen. It's going to happen. It's not going to happen this year, but Medicaid expansion is going to happen. And they're hearing from their home districts. I mean, Speaker Ralston's district, his home district, just had a rural hospital saying it was going to close. So it's happening throughout the state. I think there's, I can't remember the number, but more than a dozen rural hospitals have closed down last.
How long can they hold out? That's my question.
How long can they hold? The question is, how long can they hold out? And again,
that's what I was going to say.
So it requires legislative approval now to expand Medicaid, and that was a bill that passed in 2014 among Republicans who were worried that just in case Jason Carter or another Democrat won, that he would go in and do that immediately. So it sort of gives the legislature the veto card over expanding Medicaid. But I think that, and you saw it from the governor last year, there's sort of a plan B, that if you can get a special waiver from Medicaid to allow certain federal funding, not exactly Medicaid expansion, but sort of threading the needle, getting a half measure towards that it could smooth the path. Now, he abandoned that experiment pretty quickly after it was reported, but I think there's a lot of people working to see to really clear the runway for that for next year.
Mitch?
I have a number of questions. Dave, not for Greg.
No.
Economic impact of horse racing. Do you have any thoughts on that? Is there any studies on what the impact might be? Seems like you have a broken river.
It's interesting. The numbers I saw were pretty dramatic. I don't remember exactly what they were. It seemed like it seemed to me that the economic impact was much more tilted toward the private sector. It's difficult to look at, for whatever reason, I'm not sure what, but that doesn't seem to be as much money going, a percentage at least, going into hope from the horse racing as it would be from casinos. And the casinos, certainly subject to going up. Right now, the enabling bill says 12% would go to hope. And there's other states that dedicate a lot more than that to whatever cause they have that casino money goes to. So that's room to move that up. The horse racing, again, I just don't recall the number. It was pretty dramatic, though, the economic impact. And obviously, particularly if you happen to have one in your area, that would be a big thing.
And all the side industries and businesses.
The other conundrum about both of these, horse racing and casinos, is if you look at the example, you want to know where to put it, because the obvious place for a casino is in downtown Atlanta, where you get the convention and tourism traffic. But you saw what just happened when the idea was raised to put one at Turner Field. The people there don't want it, and they raised the same issues the mayor raised about that, which is the people who live and work in the area, low-income folks, are going to be attracted to it, and that's not good for society, that kind of thing. So you got to figure out, how do you put them somewhere where you're not going to have that kind of objection, and yet still put them where people, the visitors and the tourism folks and the conventioneers, are going to want to go to them. And of course, the horse racing proposal is also interesting, because the sheer size of this particular project that was proposed is so large that putting it anywhere in the five core counties would be kind of difficult, although they say that's where they want to go. They might even wind up somewhere like up around Lake Lanier or down in Henry County, where there's a little bit more room, because it's just a really big project that they want to do.
Yeah, I think one thing that's interesting about horse racing is this proposal is talking about 5,000 jobs, because it would be a multi-use complex. So you'd have retail and hospitality jobs, like you would have with a casino. But that industry also needs horse breeders and farmers to raise the hay and all of that. So that's part of the argument for that. Now, my recommendation, not that anybody listens, is spread a little dirt on Road Atlanta. And I think that would make for an interesting race. Marie.
A couple of years ago, there was a lot said about a supermajority of Republicans in both houses. And since then, there's not, with Mike Jacobs becoming a judge and being his seat being taken over by a Democrat, there's no longer that supermajority. Does that make any difference? And if so, can you say? And if not, there's been a lot of talk about the demographic shift in Georgia and how it's going to tilt more Democratic in years to come. Any prognosis of when you think that might happen?
Well, I don't think it makes much difference whether you have 118 Republicans in the House or 120, because you remember back when they did have 120, how do you get that many people to agree on something and vote that way? And it's very, very difficult to do it. I mean, in theory, it sounds great, but they really were not able to do anything with that significant, because they just can't get that many people together. If the Democrats as a minority locked down, which is also somewhat challenging as well, to me, really, it doesn't matter. I don't know what anybody else has to say about that.
In my opinion, the change in the split between Republicans and Democrats is only going to change marginally, at least until after the next reapportionment. I mean, Republicans are still going to be in charge the next time they draw district lines, I think. I don't know, 2030?
That's my guess.
I mean, these districts are so gerrymandered for both parties. You saw a few surprising elections. You saw Taylor Bennett winning in a Republican-leaning district in Brookhaven. You saw Janice Van Ness winning in a very Democratic district. But those are also special elections, and both those lawmakers have huge targets on their back. They already have opposition lined up, following their every move. So in the short term, you're not going to see too much of a swing. In the longer term, as demographic changes and as Hispanic population grows and as the minority population in Georgia grows, Democrats still have pretty high hopes.
Well, and you know, most legislation passes overwhelmingly. It's not necessarily unanimously, but it's very, very overwhelmingly. Now, the speaker has said that he's not bound by the Hastert rule, in the U.S. House. The Hastert rule was the entire Republican caucus had to support it. A majority of the caucus had to support a bill before it came to the floor. But Ralston doesn't live by that, but he kind of does. I mean, you don't see anything come to the floor that's not likely to pass, assuredly, except for the constitutional amendment. And that's really the only time that the Democrats get much leverage.
And look at what happened with the school takeover bill last year with that constitutional amendment. And yeah, it helped that the Republicans had, close to the supermajority in that vote. They had, but they still couldn't get their entire caucus behind it. So Deal's office needed to ply and cajole and convince Democrats to come over, and they ended up getting a handful of Democrats just to get that margin because there was a number of Republicans who just couldn't vote for the school takeover bill no matter what the governor did.
Another question?
Okay. Is there any traction for the tax cut that's been proposed?
This is a
big
question. Is this the
which card? I think not, in that the governor seems to go out of his way to keep talking about maintaining our AAA bond rating. He seems not to want to rock the boat with that kind of thing. That would be my guess.
Just give us a kind of recap on the proposals that are out there, because there's several.
Well, there's several tax cut proposals. They aim at the income tax, for example, which we've had a flat 6% forever. They keep, you know, year after year, have these proposals. But I don't know. I would think it might take until another gubernatorial election. This governor seems dug in on the fact that, and I guess he's heard from rating agencies and Wall Street and so forth, and they just don't, they're not comfortable with that. And, you know, the studies come out, and there's no studies that come out that say that Georgians are taxed at a whole lot higher rates than people in other parts of the country, and it doesn't seem to hurt our economic development. We keep on creating jobs, so I guess he doesn't see the need for it.
Yeah, I mean, I remember, I did a story one time, I guess about 6 months ago, about that, and talked to some of the rating agencies, and that's a concern for them. I mean, the Republicans point to states like Florida and Texas and say, by golly, they don't have an income tax, and look at the growth that they're having. And I say, well, what about Tennessee? They don't have an income tax. We want to be like Tennessee. You know, there may be something else that Florida and Texas has going for them other than a lack of an income tax. But Republicans are stuck on that. And I think Deal, in his heart, would love to get rid of the income tax too. But he's got to balance the budget, and he's committed to filling up the reserves to $2 billion by the end of his term. And I don't think he sees those two, you know, being able to work together. Another question. Rachel.
Yeah, I'd really love to hear more about the business community not being in favor of the Religious Freedom Act, because, you know, the legislature, I think, is very conservative, but they really rely on the business community for support. A lot of the business community is Republican. So how is this going to ultimately play out? And, you know, I know that the CEO of Delta kind of got in a lot of trouble when he mentioned, you know, gay rights and creating a welcoming community at last year's chamber lunch. And I just wonder, you know, just kind of what's happening behind the scenes with that.
Well, the happened in Indiana briefly last year, right around the same time that Senator McCoon's bill was being considered, the Senate bill here, it passed in the Senate. While that was being considered in the Georgia House, at the same time, Indiana passed a bill that just actually did cause, and there have been studies to show it, that there was, you know, a boycott, very briefly, because what happened was you had some events canceled in Indianapolis, tourism went off briefly, and what happened then was the governor got the legislature to revisit the issue. They passed another bill that was watered down a bit. He signed it, and that went away. So the fear, and I know during the interim between the sessions, the business leaders here have met the folks in Indiana, talked to them about what happened, and they are just petrified that that kind of thing would happen here. But it's interesting because there was a way to pass a law in Indiana that did not result in a boycott. They found some compromise language. It seems to have worked. But the business community doesn't seem to want to take that chance that they could happen here. They're opposed to it seemingly in any form. That's what I'm thinking, that the, you know, if the legislature satisfied with something more narrow, like the Passive Protection Act, that would basically score the bullet points they need to score with their base, I think that that would be middle ground that everybody would be happy with, including the business community. It just remains to be seen if they want to go farther than that, the Republican Party, than the business community.
I know that the House committee, when they were considering it last year, and to talk about the impact of the chamber, I think, you know, you saw them come in and propose an amendment that put the anti-discrimination clause in there, and, you know, they freaked out so much that they ended up tabling it. And it's still stuck in that House committee. I think the chamber, I think they would go along if that language was put in there, but that remains to be seen. I mean, I don't even think that, you know, we're going to see the House taking up Senate bill or the Senate taking up House bills until you get to day 30 or beyond. So it still remains to be seen what will happen.
But for at least the rest of the decade, though, that's the fundamental question the Republican Party has to come to grips with, is balancing these competing demands between an activist and hardcore base and the more establishment forces, and the chamber is the quintessential establishment force. And when you have a party that's being led again by anti-establishment figures, at least in the polls right now, with Ted Cruz and Donald Trump, it is the ongoing debate of how to balance that for Republicans who, on one hand, yeah, they get their cash, they get fueled by the chamber forces and the business communities, but on the other hand, their own voters, you know, the people who show up to these delegate meetings and these Tuesday night town halls that no one else comes to, are those people that want these hardcore red meat type of efforts.
It's interesting to me that it seems like usually the Senate is the deliberative body. It's the more pragmatic of two chambers. And this go around, in the last year or so, especially with a new majority leader and a new caucus chair, the Senate is a lot more conservative. And when they released their agenda, I've forgotten what they call it, but protecting religious rights was dead center in there. And the House seems to be, at least the House leadership seems to be, the ones that's more pragmatic. And so are we seeing a big standoff, you know, some tension being that is going to play out when we get the crossover day and especially sunny day?
It always surprises me how much the House and Senate don't seem to cooperate or coordinate with each other. They're like rival high schools. So every year you have, you know, hostage bills. Oh, the Senate's not going to move on this House bill until the House moves on the Senate bill. I don't know if that's any better or worse than it's ever been.
Well, I do miss Glenn Richardson saying, what about you're showing your back? We need some candor like that out of the leadership. So we're hoping that Mr. Ralston will loosen up a little bit. Thank you.
Can you talk about the positioning going on to run for governor after Neal?
It's already well underway. There's something like 5 or 6 different potential candidates. There's others waiting in the wings, waiting. You know, there's talk that David Perdue wants to have his own. The Perdue clan wants to have their own candidate. You know, it's pretty well established that Lieutenant Governor Cagle will likely run. Brian Kemp's been thinking about it. The question now he faces is whether or not how damaging this data disclosure is for his candidacy. Sam Owens hasn't made up his mind yet. Apparently, he doesn't tell people even privately where he's going on that one. You have Lynn Westmoreland now saying he's not running for re-election, but openly saying he's considering the governor's race. So there's 4 right there. Plus, you know, don't put it past any well-funded private business person who can self-fund their campaign, like a David Perdue, who came out of seemingly nowhere. I mean, yeah, he had a famous cousin, but who we all knew. But you know, he came out of nowhere and you know, won a very crowded GOP primary. So, and by the way, that's already starting to color this session, but will definitely play a huge role next session as Governor Deal's political capital continues to wane and he becomes sort of branded with the lame duck status. There'll be the jockeying will only increase.
Are y'all seeing that play out in bills or floor speeches?
Too early to tell. We haven't really had that committee floor speeches yet.
Yeah, that's true. I always thought that legislators should dress like NASCAR drivers, you know. They have their sponsors on their uniform. But it should also say somewhere on the back of the uniform what they're racing for, you know. Governor's office, Congress. Again, another one of my suggestions that never went anywhere. I'll tell you what, Ellie.
How do you see the presidential race that sort of claims the mix and issues being debated
It's interesting that we're going to get some, but one of the things that was that argued in favor of conservative legislation passing the general assembly that I found interesting was that a lot of Republican candidates for president are going to be through the Capitol before the primary on March 1st, and that they like things like the RFRA, for example. And that would give that bill, one of those bills, a better chance to pass the legislature. So I kind of found that interesting.
I would only say that I think within Democrats, you see maybe more of a split than you're used to. That mirrors sort of the ideological split between Hillary and Bernie. You know, you got Democrats who are like, who say the party here is not really Democratic enough. You know, you have some Democrats that are moving further left, but I don't know how much that plays into any power structure at all here.
It'll most impact in the way, and this is my view, in that qualifying begins days after the March 1st primary. So, and that's, again, that's where I just talked to a Democrat yesterday who said, oh, yeah, if Ted Cruz or Donald Trump by then is the clear winner of not only the Georgia primary, but looks like they'll be the candidate, then you're going to see a lot more Democrats getting into, you know, right now the Democrats still haven't come up with a candidate to run against Johnny Isakson. They're trying their best to tie Johnny to whatever Republican contender emerges for presidential candidate. If it's an inevitability that it'll be Cruz or Trump by then, well, we actually could see a strong Democrat contender rather than a parade of Democrats who so far have flirted with the race but instead decided, no, Johnny's too powerful to run against. So that it's qualifying is going to be a huge, the presidential race will have a huge impact on qualifying.
State Senator Mike Green from Newnan declared himself for Westmoreland seat, I guess trying to put it into speculation. He's a less quoted, fairly social conservative guy in the Senate. How do you see his campaign fitting into kind of the red meat movement? And then have you heard any rumblings of anyone else attempting to go after Westmoreland seat?
That's one of the most conservative districts in the nation. And so actually, this is going to be a very interesting race to watch because, yeah, he's very conservative. He'll have at least one or two other contenders, and two of them have already been named. Paul Brown, is his name is floating out there, even though he doesn't live in the district, he could run for that seat. There's a former representative, state representative, who sent an email a couple days ago saying he was considering running for the race. So that will be a race to the right, just like the race that Jody Heiss ended up winning in a very conservative district. And you saw the legislature rallying around Mike Crane rather than a fraternal fight between different lawmakers. Josh McCune was among them, Matt Ramsey was among them that were mentioned for that possible candidacy. So the legislature trying to rally around one candidate so they don't have that brutal, at least one brutal fight to get away.
Yeah, I would like to have been a fly on the wall in some of these cloakrooms, because I suspect that there were legislators who were hoping some of their annoying colleagues would get into that race. but Crane might have fallen in that category, you know. His first act in the legislature was to come out and rail against the lieutenant governor, and of course he gets assigned I think Mike even said this was the dog catcher committee. So he was just slowly digging himself out of that kind of stuff. So he's a firebrand, and he's my senator. So I look at him. Rachel.
Yeah, so will MARTA get legislation to allow a referendum for additional sales tax in Fulton and DeKalb's first mansion this year? And also, is the governor's plan for transportation enough, or will the legislature try to add something on for transportation?
Well, let me ask the second one first, because the idea has come up, for example, the best one I can think of immediately to change that bill from last year is the hotel industry went crazy when at the last second, and I can't really blame them because this happened in the conference committee. They were trying to do a different kind of, it was a rental car fee perhaps. They were trying to do something that they decided at the last minute would not work. So the conference committee tacked a $5 a night hotel tax on statewide to help fund that bill. And immediately the hotel folks didn't like it and railed about it as soon as the session was over. It made some good arguments, but the fact that the lawmakers are not willing to go back into that bill and even consider making that change, because they don't, the argument was that the they don't have enough certainty exactly how much revenue this is going to produce yet. It's only been around 6 months. So there's no appetite at all to go in there and do anything at all to that bill. As far as MARTA is concerned, there's certainly going to be legislation to try to get that half penny authorization to have that referendum to raise it a half penny in DeKalb and Fulton. But I don't see a whole lot of appetite in the legislature to be able to do that. One sort of complicated aspect of it that kind of gums it up is the fact that Fulton County separately is trying to take advantage or considering taking advantage of putting up another T-SPLOST referendum that would be more local in nature than the regional one that failed in 2012. And just the fact that they have these two tracks going on with that, and it's hard to get them both together because, of course, MARTA's obviously going to be for transit only, and Fulton's would not necessarily. And therefore, I think that kind of clouds the waters, but makes it more difficult.
I think Speaker Ralston initially had come out in favor of that because of the legislative breakfast that they had, that Charlie's group had. I think he spoke about shoring up MARTA. And then when we did our sit down with him, he kind of, to me, seemed like he was backing away from this. I'm not sure. And I do know that Governor Deal has said that that's going to be a local issue. So, you know, at first I would have said, yeah, there's hopes for that, but now I'm not so sure.
I'm curious, and I just wanted y'all's thoughts on this. By punting this year on QBE revisions and the other education reform proposals for a year, do you expect these things will ever come up for a vote? I mean, will these proposals that came out of the Education Commission, will we really see them next year, or are they just really gone?
I think we'll see them. I think they will come back. Now, whether, like I said earlier, I don't know if QBE is, you know, is it going to be a done deal for next year even? But I do think that we'll see it come up next year. And the merit pay, I mean, that definitely can come back up next year for teachers. I think, you know, it was put off, again, in my view, to win teachers over for re-election for other Republican candidates. But I definitely think that could probably come up next year.
I think it's the gamble of Governor Deal's second term in holding off, because you only have so much political juice left if you're a lame, if you're a second term governor going into their third year. You know, you already have other people rallying around, jockeying for his seat. So inevitably there'll be even more jockeying next year as the race, and you might have announced candidates by the beginning of the session next year. So the bet that he has enough political capital left next year to do this, and that's one of the reasons why they're backing down this year on a very more ambitious legislative agenda, is because I feel like they're trying to hoard their political capital for next year. Whether or not he has enough juice left, that'll be the big question.
You know, one story I heard was that Mrs. Deal, who spends her days going from school to school, that she spent so much time with teachers that she let him know that it wasn't going to take off. I don't know the truth of that, but anyway.
I'm wondering, do you think the governor is holding off on any action on education because there's been a big new federal law passed and he's waiting to see how it plays out, the law that replaces No Child Left Behind?
Mm-hmm. You know, he's said, and we've given him every opportunity to back down, just asking him, hey, is that one of the reasons? And he has said he remains committed to the idea of merit pay. Not of overall merit pay being one measure of how a teacher gets paid, not entirely being the only measure, but one measure. And he's remained committed to overhauling the education formula, even though that pretty much since it was passed in 1985, every governor has complained about it and wanted to overhaul that. So he has not given us any indication that he's backing down or wanting to temper what he's proposing. He just now wants it to delay the year.
Phil,
any thought about the craft beer legislation, whether that'll that might be a backdoor event that people could agree on.
Well, you know, so the Department of Revenue has ticked off the legislators so much, and they remain firm, too. I just got a confirmation last week that they're not backing down. So not only are the lawmakers coming back in to kind of adjust their bill from last year, they're actually going to change it to flat out do away with paying for the tour. They want to go back to selling there on the premises. So I think that that's their one up on the Department of Revenue.
What do you think the chances are?
I think they're pretty good. I mean, you've got Speaker behind it. I haven't really gauged that many people over in the Senate, but I do know that, that the Speaker definitely, I mean, that was his threat at the beginning of the session, was that, you know, if they don't fix it, then we will, and the Department of Revenue is not backing down. So I think that's one you can probably count on that something will happen.
Yeah, now it's kind of become an ego thing. The legislature is saying, well, you know, you're not going to pay attention to us. We'll teach you a lesson. Sometimes the biggest legislative victories come out of a little defeat like that, you know, where people get all ticked off. We got time for one last question. Who wants to mention?
So, Walter and Maggie, question. What are issues that your readers are interested in outside of Atlanta different from what the more Atlanta-focused media might be interested in covering?
I don't know if this is any different from Atlanta, per se, but what gets the most clicks, the most traffic, is marijuana, hands down.
Well, there are hot
heads
there.
Well, take it back. Yeah, but there's also, yeah, of course, people are interested in casinos, but I don't think casinos are necessarily that interested in Macon. I think it's, you know, it's a little bit of a mismatch there.
So what's the big Macon issue?
You know, I was interested that when they announced the big transportation projects that they were going to do the 170 money, one of them was a truck lane, a lane for trucks only on I-75 North between Macon and McDonough. That's not done anywhere else in the state, as far as anybody knows, and nobody exactly knows where that project came from and who suggested it.
Well, I don't know who suggested it, but it seems like it's all about getting the freight out of the port. Of course, anybody who rides, you drive down I-75 through McDonough, that area, knows it's pretty much the worst traffic nightmare. I mean, outside of Georgia 400 and I-285, if you're trying to drive a long travel trip in Georgia, it's the worst traffic, you know, weekend in and weekend out that we have in the state. And I was told just this week by one of the DOT folks that 25% of the traffic on that particular stretch between McDonough and Macon is trucks. So they want to separate them from the autos and try to get that freight to go in. Especially once they do the harbor deepening at Savannah, they're going to have a lot more freight, and they think they can move it quicker if they do that.
I would say that some of the things that may be interesting for our folks in Augusta, Athens, Savannah, for example, is the transportation bill. Take a look at this package that the governor unveiled. It's not a lot for Morris land. The city's I ride for. And so we'll see. The legislature really doesn't have any authority over that. They get to vote on it, but if they vote against it, it doesn't change anything. But we'll see. There may be some squawking about that. Talk about casinos. I thought it was interesting that the city of Savannah, the council, actually opposes casinos. Even though the only place anybody's talking about putting one other than Atlanta is Hutchinson Island, right there across the river where the state-owned convention center is. And so they're not cool on that, which may color that whole debate, because even though most of the legislators are from metro Atlanta, they're not all from there. And when you're talking about a constitutional amendment, you've got to get all the votes. And so that may be an interesting tidbit. Something else that I think has become a little bit of an odd wrinkle is the cityhood issue for years, last 10 years or so, it's been played out in North Atlanta. But now St. Simon's Island is interested in this, and they're looking at the idea of what you kind of can call a city light or a township. It would not be a full-fledged city with all the powers to have police and trash pickup and all of that, but they'd still collect a little bit of tax, but they'll control the zoning of land use in that area. So that is going to add another dynamic to that whole discussion. And there's, of course, we've got people who are interested in marijuana, a legislator from our area that I cover put in the lowering it to a misdemeanor. So it was surprising that that came from somewhere out of Metro Atlanta. He says he's safe in his district, and that's what people there are talking about. So, I've rambled on and I've used up all of our time, but we need to go out and get work and embrace the day. Let's thank our.
Yeah, good luck. Yeah, that was very good.